The crisis in South Sudan essentially is a crisis of leadership. It is a crisis of leadership that has lost vision, that has lost direction, and has separated from the core values of SPLM, the values that underpin the struggle of the SPLM and the people of Sudan and South Sudan in particular. And the loss of vision has resulted into this crisis, as it is in the proverb that where there is no vision, people perish. The people of South Sudan are perishing today because of loss of vision. That is where how I define the crisis and the root causes of the crisis in South Sudan. SPLM led the people of South Sudan during their struggle under the leadership of Dr. John Garang Demobior, who defined the vision of the new Sudan, of a new society, as the paradigm for which we struggled. That vision defined a very clear dream, a dream that has mobilized all the marginalized people in Sudan, and particularly the people of South Sudan. Under the leadership of Dr. John Garang Demobior, the people of South Sudan were able to affirm their right to self-determination in the battlefield, on the negotiating table, diplomatically, and it was under the vision of John Garang that the people of South Sudan were able to rise up to all the challenges. They were able to see themselves as one people, one united people. Under that leadership, the people of South Sudan were inspired that even very innocent, unempowered young people from the countryside were able to join and form an army inspired by that vision and inspired by that charismatic leadership to become a very mighty force that was able to dictate the will of the people on the oppressors of our people. With that vision, we fought the war. It was a great liberation war. With that vision, we negotiated an agreement that came to be known as one of the greatest agreements in Africa and in the world. And we lost Dr. John Garang Demobior at a very critical time of transition. Transition from war to peace. John Garang and the leadership of SPLM, led by him and inspired by him, had a clear strategy of transition from war to peace. A strategy that includes very important plans for transition in all the sectors. First is in transforming the SPLM from a liberation movement, a liberation organization, into a post-liberation political organization and party capable of providing leadership in the context of peace, in the context of multi-party democracy. John Garang and the leadership of SPLM had a plan to transform the SPLA, the army, into a conventional state army, a professional army that would have become a national institution, not only to protect the integrity of South Sudan, but also as an institution that would have educated our young people in the spirit of the values that guided us during the struggle, that would have educated our young people in nationalism and patriotism, and would have united our people. John Garang and the SPLM leadership under him had a plan of building a new civil service, a new state organs, a civil service that would have been genuinely a true servant to the people, with totally different orientation, an orientation of a state that serves the people, that puts the people at the center of its attention, and replaced the oppressive state institution. John Garang and the SPLM leadership under him had plans and strategies to transform our economy from a peasant, rural, agricultural-based economy into a modern economy. He thought of plans of using the oil money to fuel, and he used to say, and I quote, use the oil money literally to fuel our agriculture, so that we modernize our agriculture, so that we have commercial agriculture, an agriculture that produces surplus beyond, and transform the subsistent agriculture to a real surplus producing agriculture, both for our domestic market as well as for export, and diversify our economy. John Garang and the SPLM leadership under him had strategies to transform our society, to build infrastructure, to build new towns, and he talked about the concept of taking towns to the people and not bringing or attracting the people to slums, in towns, unplanned towns. He had all these strategies, but then at that critical moment of transition, we lost him. The loss was a grave tragedy for the people of South Sudan, for the SPLM. And John Garang, as a great historical personality, accounted for maybe about 40% of the energy of SPLM. Though he was a single individual, but he had the capacity to energize, he had the capacity to inspire even the simplest uneducated peasant and make him a mighty person. He was that type of a leader that Napoleon described as, that if you have an army of rabbits led by a lion, that army will roar like lions. But then if you have a misfortune of an army of lions. Led by a rabbit, they will be running to their holes, even though they are lions. That is the tragedy that has befallen South Sudan and the SPLM. At that critical time, of course, we had no time to waste. We had no luxury to indulge in. We needed to keep the momentum and not to lose that momentum of the peace agreement. And the SPLM leadership did not waste any time, but asked Comrade Salva Kiir Mayardit to take over the leadership and lead us forward to implement the peace agreement and to ensure that the people of South Sudan exercise their right to self-determination. That was our focus. And indeed, he did take over the leadership. But unfortunately, the nature and the characteristics of the leadership that Comrade Salva Kiir provided has been a disintegrative leadership, has been a type of leadership that actually demoralizes those who were under him, because he was more focused on looking behind and blaming everybody for whatever that was going wrong, and he was not providing leadership, he was not showing the way. And that is where our tragedy has come. Now that this has happened, the crisis essentially as a result of loss of vision and direction led into an internal debate within the SPLM. This internal debate within the SPLM on whether we were doing the right things or we're doing the wrong things. Some of us were saying that the SPLM is going the wrong direction, that the SPLM is failing to deliver on its promises to the people, made during the struggle or even made during the last elections, that the SPLM leadership is committing mistakes. And others were saying no, everything was okay, everything was good, we were doing the right things, and they started to become angry of why there is criticism or self-criticism. During that debate, of course, one of the issues that was also approaching was the issue of succession, change of leadership. And with a number of SPLM leaders offering themselves, and the incumbent felt challenged, Comrade Salva Kiir felt challenged. But that internal debate about mistakes being made and need to be corrected, or even the debate about change of the need to change the leadership, was a healthy internal debate. In every political party, these things come up from time to time. When mistakes are made, there are voices that must come up to call for corrections of mistakes. And also, when cycles of leadership change come, after every period of legitimacy that expires and new, fresh mandate are sought for within the party or even at the state level, this debate comes. What is unfortunate is that in December 2013, the debate took a wrong turn, a wrong direction. With President and Chairman Salva Kiir Mayardit introducing violence into the crisis. Then killings happened in Juba, and that resulted into a rebellion of those who felt were being targeted. And that is how Dr. Riek Machar ran out from Juba for his own life. And he found so many people in Jungle State, and it spread to other states, particularly SPLA officers and soldiers deserting from different units from the Nuer nationality because of the massacres that were targeting the Nuer nationality in Juba. And also armed civilian population known as the White Army were also rising up in revenge or in bitterness for the killings that took place in Juba. That is how the country fell into the civil war that we have. What is unfortunate that this war, this civil war, took tribal character, and it took also the nature of wiping up tribalistic emotions and hatred and anger in the country. So you have this devastating civil war that we have in the country. Now, this civil war is threatening to destroy the young nation, and the young nation is falling increasingly and rapidly into disintegration. Even this civil war is also taken, because it has taken tribalistic characteristics, with massacres and killings being conducted on tribal ground. But now new movements are also emerging. You have General Lulong has now rebelled. You have also rebellions in Equatoria that are coming up. If we are not careful, the country can actually collapse into tribal warfare, where tribes or clans would be butchering each other. That will destroy the state. Our social fabric has been destroyed. That we saw as a very dangerous development. Even the way this war has started, or where it was started in Juba, and we chose not to join any side of the war, and we said yes, we need reform, we need change, we need total transformation of our state takes. We said yes, we need to transform and reform the SPLM and reunite it, because it has splintered into factions. We have three factions that are known now, but there are many other SPLM members who have left and got disappointed. So now we have two problems. One problem is a problem of war that is raging in our country, that has taken a lot of lives lost, and it has displaced millions of our people. This war has threatened now South Sudan to such a degree that 40% of our population are at risk of starvation. 30% of our population can only survive on humanitarian assistance, food. Our economy has collapsed. This war, if it is allowed to continue, there will be no victor in it, but all of us, all South Sudanese, both the two warring parties, are actually fighting themselves to destruction. They are destroying themselves. But in the process, they are destroying South Sudan. So all South Sudanese are going to be the losers. Because very soon, if we are not careful, if we fail to stop this war, we will lose the state itself. And when we lose the state, then it will be anarchy and chaos all over the place. We need to stop this war. That is the first national priority in our view as a group. This war is being fought by two SPLM factions. The SPLM in government, led by President Kiir, and the SPLM in opposition, led by former deputy chairman of the SPLM, Dr. Riek Machar, former vice president of South Sudan. As a group, we believe that this war must be stopped. For us, we believe the only way to stop this war is through engaging in a serious national dialogue. It is by talking. Cannot be by guns. The voices or the sounds and of the bullets and guns will not solve the problem. Will lead to disintegration of South Sudan, in our view. So the way to stop this war is to engage in serious national dialogue. And we have taken the initiative to engage both the warring parties, to engage President Kiir and the leadership of SPLM in government, and to engage Dr. Riek Machar, the chairman of SPLM in opposition, in a national dialogue. So that is our initiative. But the second problem is that the SPLM is divided. So we must also enter into dialogue to reunite the SPLM. And we engage each other as the three factions with the facilitation of Tanzania ruling party, CCM, and sign the Arusha peace agreement. But the Arusha peace agreement has been delayed to be implemented because the SPLM in government created a lot of obstacles that obstructed the implementation of the Arusha agreement, which has also made the SPLM in opposition to be reluctant or to drag their feet on the Arusha implementation process. Last meeting that we had in South Africa, the SPLM in opposition did not attend because of the obstruction, and they lost interest in the process of reunification of SPLM. And for achieving these two national goals, ending the war and bringing peace and implementing the Arusha agreement to reunite the SPLM, these two objectives of peace and unity of SPLM, we took the initiative and engaged the grantors of the Arusha agreement, and we asked them if we could join together to engage the SPLM leadership in government in Juba to remove all the hurdles that they have created and placed blocking the implementation of the Arusha peace agreement, and they agreed. But then we told them, what will be the use to unite the SPLM when we have no country, when there is no peace in that country? We must have peace. So we asked them whether we could work together with the IGAD countries so that we bring closer coordination between the peace process to end the war and the reunification process to reunite the SPLM. They agreed, and we engaged also the Kenyan and Ethiopian foreign ministers who contacted the Arusha guarantors and agreed for us to have one meeting together. We met and we agreed that we take the initiative to engage the two SPLM factions at war, to stop the war and to implement the Arusha agreement. And that is how the process began and matured. We are grateful to President Uhuru Kenyatta, who hosted us and hosted our meetings and took the initiative to facilitate this process. So we have begun the engagement with the two SPLM factions that is at war, and they are our actually largest factions of the SPLM, not only in fighting the war, but even in terms of size of membership of SPLM who are under them in the areas they control or outside the country. That is how an initiative, that is how we see the way forward for our country. And it is through dialogue, engaging in dialogue to stop this war and rescue South Sudan from collapsing into chaos and disorder, and engaging in removing all the hurdles and obstacles so that we implement the Arusha agreement and reunite the SPLM and return it, restore it to its vision, which is essentially has been the root cause of the crisis that we have in South Sudan, lost of vision. Mediators, and our late founding father, Dr. John Garang Dumebier, used to say that you cannot be a mediator in your own cause. We are not mediators. We are party to the problem itself, and we are a stakeholder in the negotiations of both IGAD and Arusha. We had and have positions that we have been presenting. The initiative we are taking now is exercising leadership, and we are exercising leadership and taking all the risk to engage the other two SPLM factions. As far as the Arusha agreement is concerned, an agreement has already been negotiated. We have already negotiated it. Our effort is to engage the SPLM and government to remove the hurdles and obstacles that they have created through this dialogue. And I'm happy to report to you and to your viewers that this initiative has given good results so far. We have engaged the SPLM leadership. We have discussed with them the obstacles that we see that they have created, and the need for them to be removed so that we can reunite the SPLM. And there is agreement on that. Chairman Salfakir Mayadid, chairman of the SPLM, has promised to take bold and tough decisions to remove these obstacles so that we are able to implement the Arusha Agreement. We will be taking a mission also to discuss with the SPLM in opposition leadership, with Dr. Riek Machar and the other leaders of SPLM in opposition, to discuss with them the need to renew their interest in the implementation of the Arusha Agreement, the need for them not to remain behind, but to fully participate so that we reunite the SPLM. And we are hopeful that this will also get positive results. And this will be a result of dialogue. This is not our achievement. This is not going to be our achievement. Like what happened in Juba was not our achievement. It was an achievement of both SPLM factions that entered into that dialogue. We are also engaging the two warring parties, the two SPLM factions that are at war, to persuade them, to convince them, to pressure them to stop this war. What are the tools that we have to do that? The main tool is this dialogue. But we'll be sharing realities on the ground. We'll be sharing how our country is collapsing, how our country is getting destroyed, how our country is disintegrating, and how this war, if it is allowed to continue, we will even not have a country that they are fighting for. And therefore, the need to stop this war. We are sure that they see the reality as we see it, but in dialogue, together, we'll be able to come to assume the responsibility to rescue South Sudan. It was positive in our engagement in Juba, and we are hopeful that it will also be positive in our engagement in Pagag with the leadership of SPLM in opposition. And this will result into two things: that the hurdles that has been blocking the achievement of peace would be removed. All of us now will be able to go back to the table of IGAD, where the mediators are, with a clearer understanding among us of the need to rescue our country. An understanding that will make us assume and take the responsibility for our country. To rescue it from collapsing and disintegrating. It will make us, all the SPLM three factions, as well as also other national political parties who are stakeholders, so that we assume that responsibility to take away the shame that we have caused to ourselves and to our country. The image of our country today is in the dust. South Sudanese, after a few years, 2 years of the whole world celebrating for us today, they are literally asking, what is wrong with you people? Did you fight and struggle to become independent so as to kill yourself? Definitely not. Even the IGAD mediation, today many people are saying that the IGAD has failed to bring peace in South Sudan. But in actual fact, it is not the IGAD that has failed. It is South Sudanese leaders who have failed to bring peace to South Sudan. And peace to South Sudan will not be brought by mediators. It will be brought about by leaders. So when we engage in this national dialogue, we are not engaging as mediators. We are not mediating between President Kiir and former Vice President Riek Machar, no. We are engaging them as equal stakeholders, as responsible people, as they are, as we are all are, so that we assume and exercise responsibility and statesmanship for our country, for our people, for the generations to come. So in that sense, we are not a new mediation. We are interested party. We are genuinely part of the problem, but assuming the responsibility of being part of the solution or producing the solution. And it can only come from all of us. Our relationship is good. We were calling for the same objective of the need to avoid the country becoming a dictatorship, the need to reform the SPLM, the need to correct the SPLM and return it to its vision, which it has lost. And these were issues that we were discussing together as SPLM leaders and members. And you remember we made our press conference in the SPLM house. And we were SPLM. And until violence was introduced by the SPLM, which has now become the faction in the government, though they have accused us of having attempted a coup, but the truth has come to be known. Even day to day, I'm not talking about that there was a coup. It was a cover up for the violence that they started themselves. With SPLM-IO, we have one difference, only one difference, and that is a tactical difference in terms of means of a struggle, how to achieve the objectives that we share. They say they will have a number of means, including the armed struggle. We say we use all the means with exception of the armed struggle. That is the only difference between us. So they have armed struggle in the tools that they use, and we exclude the armed struggle in the tools that we use. We are not condemning the armed struggle. We have been freedom fighters in the struggle. I've been a commander in the SPLM. I am among those who started the war of liberation even before the SPLM, SPLA. So that I have no issue with the armed struggle. But in our view, given the fact that our country is young and it is a young state that is still very fragile, use of the armed struggle may destroy it. And this is being proven now in the 1.5 years of the army struggle, how the country is about to collapse. That was what we saw. Also, we saw the danger of the of our country collapsing into tribal perverse violence. And we have experience in the war itself, but we saw it like it could be a very strong tool to use, but you have to be very careful because not every strong medicine can be administered to a sick patient. You must also see what type of a patient that you are trying to use. If you do an overdose of a medicine, you may kill the patient. You will kill the disease and the patient itself. And the army struggle for us is like a very potent, strong, you know, chemical concoction that can kill the cancer that our patient is having. But it is so strong that if you administer it, it will kill the cancerous cells as well as the good cells. So it will kill the patient. Arm struggle in our case, in our view, and we have shared this with the leadership of IO in the beginning when we were released, that the arm struggle is a very powerful tool, powerful medicine to treat our state which has caught a cancer. And that it may kill the patient itself. That is the difference that we have. But it is a tactical difference, it's not a strategic difference. Therefore, we have maintained dialogue and engagement, and on that basis we have met from time to time, we have coordinated our activities, and on that basis we are taking this initiative to engage the leadership of SPLM in opposition so that we rescue ourselves.
Yes, we have good relations with the other political parties. In actual fact, the leadership of the other political parties that participated in the talks, we have engaged in discussions in trying to bring closer our positions in the negotiations together. And the other political parties and G10 have coordinated and provided, in most of the cases, the middle ground, bridging the gap between the position of the SPLM in government and the government and the SPLM in opposition. And when the government conspired to exclude them from the talks, we were the first to call for their freedom, to be free to come and continue participating in the negotiations. And we have always called for Dr. Lamakol to be free, to move in and outside of the country, to come and participate, or to do any other political work that they may want to do, even outside the country. So we have good relations with the political parties inside the country. We coordinate. Even we have good relations with other new political parties, like the People's Liberal Party and their chairman. When the chairman of the People's Liberal Party was arrested, we called for his release, and we campaigned for his freedom. And we talked to them from time to time. So we engage with all the political parties in the country, whether the old ones or even the young ones, the new ones. I'm optimistic
that peace will come back sooner than many people expect. Our mission to Juba was very successful, and we believe a number of obstacles have been removed on the side of the SPLM and government. We are also hopeful that we will take that positive message to the leadership of SPLM in opposition, and we will also seek to remove whatever obstacles that may be there on the side of SPLM-IO, and we are very hopeful on that. I cannot go into the details to protect the process itself and the peace that would come. We will be also engaging the SPLM, as we engage the both SPLM in opposition and in government, we will be engaging also the mediators so that we discuss with them the outstanding issues and how to bring peace to our country soonest. Absolutely, accountability is important. There is need for accountability and justice, so that justice is done, especially for the victims, but also justice and accountability is done so that we are able to heal the nation. Accountability is important so that we deal away with impunity, so that we prevent recurrence of such gross violations like massacres, like ethnic cleansing that South Sudan has seen. And I believe it is important to agree on the process of accountability, transitional justice, within the agreement itself. The peace agreement must include accountability. Our priority, our national priority, I must repeat, is peace. It is healing, it is reconciliation, it is reunification of our nation, of our people, that has been divided by all these atrocities, and that has been wounded fatally, almost. That being our priority, we are not saying that accountability and justice would be sacrificed, but we are saying that you bring peace, you stop the killing, so that you can account for those who have been killed. But you must stop the killing first. You must stop those who are alive not to be killed. And that is a necessity. And that's how we see it. To the people of South Sudan, I have a very simple message. One is not to lose hope. We are going through, yes, the most darkest moment of our life as a nation, as a sovereign state. Divisions that have befallen us, and people have been divided along tribal lines. Emotions are high. It is time for us to make peace. And peace should not be seen as a function of negotiations among the leaders. We have to make peace, all of us as South Sudanese. We have the responsibility as South Sudanese to bring about this change so that we build a peaceful and a prosperous South Sudan, so that we genuinely become a free nation, because we struggle to be free. And we can only be free when we are peaceful, when we create wealth and achieve prosperity, so that we can build and lead a life of dignity and abundance. As it is in our national prayer and national anthem, we ask God to uphold us united. We actually ask God and our motherland to uphold us united in peace and harmony. This dream, as we have sung it, will come true. And it is our responsibility, all of us. My message to the leaders, especially to the leaders, South Sudanese leaders who are leading this war, President Kiir and Dr. Riek Machar, I say, enough is enough. Despite the bitterness, despite the wrongs that have been done, we have to stop this war now and make peace, and build a peaceful South Sudan where we can be able to correct our mistakes, where we can be able to heal ourselves, where we can be able to rescue our nation and build a genuinely prosperous country where we are able to lead our people to make the dream of our founding father, Dr. John Garang Demobio, and all our martyrs come true.